Hello learners, I welcome you all in this video program which is related to know your economy. If we talk about our economy, the study of economy, aggregates of economy, the study is very, very large. But to understand only just the beginning overview of our Indian economy, we have our expert, Dr. J. Khuntia. He is associate professor in Delhi University, Open School of Open Learning. He is here to support our learners to understand the basic overview of our economy in this program. Later on, we are going to discuss more and more in detail also, but he is today only focusing the general overview. Sir, I welcome you on behalf of NIOS to support our learners. As you know, this is also an open learning system. So this is, student can learn through this video programs and self-learning material. I also like to share this thing. Sir has also supported a lot in supporting, in making and in framing of self-learning material of NIOS also. So sir, let's start with overview of Indian economy.
I will be highlighting, you know, India is a very vast economy. It has large population, and you know that India is second largest after China in terms of its population, that you know. And it is also the largest democracy in the world because of its vast population, and we have system where people choose their representative. It's a peaceful country and it's very important. Now it's an emerging economy also, because it is growing very fast, okay, over the years. So I will today focus on how Indian economy has evolved, what are its features today, and what it promises tomorrow. Okay, so we'll divide this topic into three parts. The first part will be Indian economy during the British period, because you know that the Britishers ruled this country for more than 200 years. Okay, and it's a significant portion in time. And when you talk about Indian economy, Indian polity, Indian society, we cannot forget what happened during the British period, because that has got influence over what is happening today. So during British period, if we study the British economy, we will find four major features. During the British period, these features are basically, you will find negative in character. Why? Negative in character because Britishers came here to exploit the country through trade. First, they entered as traders, then they captured the economy, its polity, and influenced the whole society in terms of exploiting its resources for their own benefit. Okay? So, if we try to understand the British system, then we can understand it in the following manner. Number one is the decline of handicraft industry. Okay? Number two is production of cash crops. Number three is famines and food shortage. And number four is rise of intermediaries in agriculture. You see, we can divide our British period economy into basically these four major parts. First, let us understand decline of handicraft industry. What does it mean? Before the British came, who were ruling the country? The Mughal Empire. And they were having vast empire. And there were Mughal kings and emperors who ruled this country, including the names, great names like Akbar the Great, okay, Shahjahan, Jahangir, Aurangzeb, Babur. They were big Mughal emperors. During their period of nearly Mughal dynasty's rule is nearly four centuries. During their period, what happened? One industry grew very fast, and that was called the handicraft industry. If you look at handicrafts, you find beautiful Mughal paintings, for example, on the walls of those Agra fort. If you visit, you visit Lal Killa in Delhi. They were supporting these labor who were skilled in painting, stone carving, I mean all these things. And if you look at the clothes, designs in the Mughal Darbars, drapery in the Mughal Darbars, you will find how beautiful they were. And those industries were growing in the urban areas, small towns. So for example, the World City area of Delhi. When Britishers entered this country, their first job was to capture the Mughal kingdom. So they fought wars, they defeated kings. So as a result, urban areas of those periods were destroyed. So where these industry will go? The people fled to the rural area. The industry got destroyed. So Indian industry, the typical Mughal supported industry, got destroyed. So decline of Indian handicraft became one of the major features of the British economy. If you look at Lal Killa, for example, you see how beautifully it is, I mean, designed, and the building. They are all part of your, you know, hard labor put by those skilled construction worker of those times. Then come to, during British period, another problem was there. The indigo cultivation was also very famous. What happened during indigo cultivation? Why it was famous? Because they were actually growing cash crops. So this is also another major feature. Increase production of cash crops. What is cash crop? That gives you raw material to feed the industries in Britain. You grow raw cotton in the Bombay belt, you know that, those Maharashtra belt, black soil, it's famous for cotton.
Yes, Vapi and all.
Okay. And they are traders, they could easily know the value of these. And the industries in Britain was growing that time. So they used to, you know, influence the farmers here by giving them money, bribing them that you cultivate these crops. What happened? These people, you know, they were attracted by British money. They think that, yes, we are getting more money by cultivating these crops. So indigo was famous for, you know, dyes. They were making dyes on textiles. And that time, in Europe, it was most famous. They were demanding indigo from India. So that was the time when Britishers, you know, in India, they gave Indian farmers this money to grow these crops, and the material, the production, the crops were being sailed through to the Britain for their industries to grow. So they were using the raw materials, their labor was getting employment there, and the finished products from British will come and being sold in the country. So India was a vast market. What is the next? The next is, as I talked to you, growing famines during this period. British period, more than nearly 40 to 50 famines took place. Famine is starvation due to hunger and disease. During the British period, as I said, when people were in a way forced to, farmers were forced or in a way bribed also to grow cash crops, food production came down. That was one problem. Even if it was not a very major problem, the major problem was actually in the form of low purchasing power of people. So market price went up, high market price, all these things, starvation, hunger due to hunger, they all took place. And if you see the statistics, it is really mind-boggling. I mean, really tragic story. In Bengal famine of 1943, 1.5 million people died, and 3.5 million people suffered from diseases. They also died. It was, and in 1876-78, I have quoted this, 6 to 10 million people died in South India. These two statistics I have given, and if you look at the pictures, they are really terrifying pictures. One is of Bengal famine in the left corner, and the second one is 1876-78 picture. Somebody has drawn it, and we have downloaded these pictures from Google search. So I must tell you that where these materials have come. What happened to agriculture? This is also very important. Britishers borrowed the system from Mughals, particularly the Jamindari system. Okay? There are two types of revenue system during the British period. One is permanent settlement and the other one is temporary settlement. You know, Britishers' major objective was to collect revenue. Resource-wise, Indian economy was really rich. So how they tapped the resources? Land revenue was the major source of money. So permanent settlement means fix the revenue permanently. And temporary settlement means revise the revenue every 25 years or 30 years, depending on the market rate that time. Permanent settlement gave rise to what is commonly known as Jamindari system in the Bengal province. If you look at the revenue map of British India, in the picture you will find two colors. One is Bengal province, which is on the right hand side corner and spreading towards north. On the south, it was Roitwari system and Mahalwari on the west. That is, it covered Gujarat, Bombay that time, Rajasthan, parts of Rajasthan. Jamindar was a person who was most influential in a village or in a locality, fine, and he was given the job of collecting revenue. Slowly and slowly, the position of Jamindar was such that he became even powerful like a king. Okay, the Britishers were somewhere else. He was given charge to collect the revenue from the people. So locally, he became very powerful. And for everything, people depended on the Jamindar for giving judgments, settling disputes, okay, for any kind of problem, they used to go to the Jamindar because there was no Mughal king that time. So Britishers depended on Jamindar to take the revenue as well. Over a period of time, the Jamindar became so powerful and even exploitative that he will keep a part of the revenue with him and give another part to the government. That way, he also multiplied his wealth. Okay? Similarly, the Raitwari system in south, different from Jamindari system, but the totally in end result was same. He was the middleman, and Mahalwari on the west. They used to collect the revenue. And like a Jamindar, they were also behaving very tyrannically, because when you give power to a person, over a period of time, they start exploiting people. Indian people were very poor. They were also not considering the status of poor status of the farmers or local people. They were interested in collecting money. So that is why British period was really notorious for its exploitative culture. That is why we say British Raj was not good for India, because agriculture being the dominant occupation of people, and this is suffering because of the, you know, tyranny of the Jamindars.
Sir, our students are also keen to know something means what a Britisher did else, something different for our economy. As you said, India is rich, but Indians are poor. And on the other side, there is always a possibility for good things. And we know there is always a silver lining in every cloud. So our students, they are very keen to know about some contribution of Britishers. So we have some learners also. Samyak is here. He want to ask some question.
So my question is, what were the positive changes brought by Britishers?
Positive changes. Okay, fine. I mean, you see, it's very correct. 200 years of British rule, we say Indian people, the modernization in India was brought by the Britishers also. We were people, in thinking perhaps backward, or we are not showing our culture to the rest of the world. The positive things of India were not known. When Britishers came here, interacted here and went also, and they had empires all over the world. So when their people visited our country and also, went to other parts of the world, they also took with them the memories of India. So India got known outside, and it is the great contribution here comes from the Britishers, that India was known to the outside world. Besides that, you see, Britishers contributed in terms of industrialization as well and developing the service sector that we see today that is growing. Mm. You know, it started with railways. Indian railway is one of the biggest network, largest network in the world. And today, and it is because of the British. The first railway was laid during the 1956-7, during that period. Then the cotton mill came to being during the British period. The jute mill, coal mine, telecommunication, telegraph, post office. Even iron and steel plant, the first time, which was started by the famous Tata. It was during the British period only, before India got independence. So we cannot forget actually, because these are the infrastructure they definitely gave to India. Okay. And on that basis, today also we are growing. we inherited the British system, fine. We inherited negative things and positive things also, okay. But the negative things were very heavy on us because, you see, after the Britishers left, we were given the scope to rule this country, okay. Jawaharlal Nehru became the first prime minister, okay. Even though our independence was not very, you know, memorable in the sense that the great Mahatma Gandhi, our father of nation, died immediately, who contributed a lot for the independence of this country. But Jawaharlal Nehru took over as prime minister and continued the legacy, okay. And he led this country during those tough times in a very good manner, you can say. Jawaharlal Nehru's major contribution after independence was introduction of 5-year planning in India, okay. You see, we had many poor people in the country when Britishers left. Our agriculture was very poor. We were industrially totally backward, okay. We were having shortage in food production. So, those challenges were to be met. So, Nehru introduced 5-year planning to tackle these challenges. You know, planning is necessary, and we followed a Soviet system that time. We borrowed the planning idea from Soviet Rus. Well, they had got planning in their country. So, you focus on certain issues and try to solve it during those period.
Sir, ye panchvarshiya yojana kya hoti hai?
5-year planning, jisko hum panchvarshiya yojana kehte hain, it's about making some or formulating certain objectives and solve them on a 5-year basis. That is the tenure we have given. So, after 5 years is over, we will review it. Even the midterm reviews are also done. And then in the next 5 years, again prepare the budget, bring the resources and try to correct whatever is left out and also fix more target for future. Okay. So, 5-year planning started with the first 5-year plan in 1951, okay. And after that, we have been continuing with 5-year planning. Say, after 5 years, the second 5-year plan in 1956. There was only one problem during 1966 to 1969, when 5-year planning could not be done, because Indian economy during that period was running through a very bad patch, okay. There was, India fought 2 wars that time, one with China, one with Pakistan. There was a drought situation in the country. Yes. So, we were not trying to get, we are trying to get resources, but they were very in short supply. So, enough money was not there to, you know, fund these plans. So, we had annual plans during that period. Again, we restarted the 5-year planning after these 3 annual plans after 1969. And another feature, with this 5-year planning today, we are trying to grow, fix our targets. Like, what are the objectives? For example, one is reducing the poverty, inequality in the country, poverty and inequality, which is rampant in the country. So many poor people are there. Achieve full employment, employment for youth. Yes, growing population. Every year, young people are coming up. So, for example, from National Open School, you see so many people, students are enrolled, and so many students try to get educated, then join formal stream in higher education, then get degrees, then join the labor market, employment market. They aspire, hope for better jobs. Who will provide the job? The government, of course, and government is definitely under tremendous, burden. They have to fulfill the ambition of people, but where the resources will come? So, one objective of planning is to reduce this unemployment and mobilize resources to reduce them. Also poverty, because that is also major challenge before the country. We have inequality also, that is gap between rich and gap between rich and poor. We have some urban areas which is very developed, like Delhi, New Delhi you see, and go to some other small town in or a city in a state. You can compare the level of development, and we are bothered about this, that why this is happening, why there is a poor person on the street who is begging, and why another person who is very rich going in a car, okay, why this is happening. So, people are, government is exercised about all these things. So that is one of the major objectives, that to reduce poverty and unemployment. Then population pressure. You see, we are adding, you must know, we are adding one Australia to our population every year. This is alarming. And people means more people, which is going beyond control, means more problem. You see queues in front of paying the electricity bill. Mm-hmm. You see queues in front of schools and colleges to pay. In education, you don't get schools also nowadays because of heavy population pressure. Infrastructure is not available. Okay, hospitals are in shortage. We are not able to provide health care, drinking water. Resources are getting scarce.
But sir, thankfully, this five-year plan, they are improving the situation day by day.
Yeah.
If we see some areas, some states like Rajasthan, Maharashtra, even we go to Madhya Pradesh, their government is doing lot many things to improve the condition of poor people.
Yeah.
Means this is all possible through planning only.
Yeah.
And although we were late in implementing the plan, that planning commission in 1951, in comparison to Pakistan and China, but now means present, our planning is growing much better than the other countries. Am I right, sir? Means overall how our planning is working?
Yeah, true. That is because our country is very successful as a democracy.
Yes.
We participate in debate, discussions. Our Panchayati Raj system is growing, getting stronger. We have a strong parliamentary democracy. Our state governments are functioning through their legislative assemblies.
Okay.
So people are participating. That is one major, success areas of the country, that people are participating in the development process. We have also to think about our agriculture. You see, still India is depending on agriculture. It is good that agriculture should grow, but more population pressure on agriculture is also giving a signal that our industries and other sectors are not growing perhaps. We have still 50% of our population in agriculture. At the time of independence, it was 70%. Okay? So that is the reason why we want our agriculture also to grow. So post-independence, we are trying to work through planning. We are trying to control our population. We are trying to grow our per capita income and national income also, because that is how we grow. And our average income is, what is our per capita income in comparison to America or some European countries? 1/50th, yani 50 times their per capita income is, our per capita income is 50 times less. That is what I want to tell. So we must grow. So that is also a challenge. Then what is the promise for future? Promise for future is, we want not only our agriculture to grow, but we are trying our rules, regulations, policies to change so that people can easily understand them and accordingly participate in the development process. And nobody will be barred or obstructed from participating in the development process. That is called economic reforms. Okay? There were certain very stringent or rigid rules earlier. If you want to, invest money somewhere, start an industry, you have to take lot of pain in terms of getting permission from the government. It is called licensing system. Nowadays, government is now liberalizing it. It is saying that no need of such type of licensing. If you want to develop something, invest some money somewhere, you can do it unless it is a strategic one. So we are trying to arrest unemployment now through a scheme called National Rural Employment Guarantee. So guarantee program or act. That act was passed in the parliament. It provides you guarantee of 100 days employment at least. Once an act is enacted, now it is the job of the government, duty of the government to, help you getting 100 days of employment. This is some very good development, you can say, in the recent years of the government. And this is a picture from Right to Work, 100 days employment, that is what is government is doing for you. This is that logo, Rashtriya Gramin Rozgar Guarantee Adhiniyam. And these are certain, pictures of India's development, nuclear power, which is recently government is, you know, supporting this power generation through nuclear energy. You see the city life in Mumbai. You understood them.
Thank you, sir, for sparing your valuable time for us and just showing us the path right from independence to then planning commission, then some up and downs of Indian economy, and then to new economic policy, and then coming to the 21st century and this new technological world. And means, in a nutshell, I want to say ki sir has given us lot many information about the overall overview of the economy, a journey, the complete journey in a very different way, with some pictures, with some value addition, and overall the future also, what we are just hoping, although we are doing our means every day, we are doing so many things for better tomorrow. So sir, on behalf of NIUS, I extend my heartfelt thank to you for sharing your views, your means, your ideas in a very interactive mode. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
And I also extend my thanks to learners also, because without learners, this program is meaningless.
Yeah, yeah.
This again, as we said, ki our country is a full democracy is there. So this program is also for the people, by the people, and it is exclusively for our learners only to take the benefit and advantage of this program. Thank you once again.
प्रकाशित करने राहों को आलोकित करने हम अपना दीपक स्वयं बने हम अपना रास्ता स्वयं चुने कभी पढ़े हम कहीं पढ़े वे विषय के लोच से